Welcome back, everyone. Dan Vega here, and today I'm answering one of your questions, so let's just get right into it. I got this question over on the Spring Office Hours podcast discussion board, and the question is titled Spring Boot Annotation and XML-based Configuration. Hi, Spring Boot provides annotations which we can use to create beans. I have seen projects where the developers have used annotations and XML-based configuration to configure beans, schedules, etc. What are your thoughts on using only annotation or both annotations and XML-based configuration? Is there any case where using both can be helpful? Thanks. Thanks for the wonderful question here. It's a really good question, and I think it's one we can dive into today. So, there are multiple ways to configure your Spring applications. When we started out, we only had one way. We started out with XML configuration. Then we moved on to Java configuration. And through Java configuration, we use annotations. And so if you are in an application that uses XML configuration heavily, maybe it's a legacy project. Maybe it's something that we're not updating all the time. If I start a brand new project today, I'm using Java-based configuration. I'm using annotation-based configuration. With that said, there's nothing wrong with XML configuration. It can be a little bit more verbose to kind of configure things, but that's okay. Functionally, it's doing the same thing. And your question to what are your thoughts on using both? My thoughts are great. If you are in an application that started out as an XML-based configuration and you're slowly working in some Java configuration using annotations, that's fine. Maybe you don't want to take on the overhead of converting all of that XML into Java-based configuration. For what gain, right? We need to spend our time wisely. And for me, that's not really a wise way to spend our time, just doing that mass conversion just to get it out of XML. So I'll leave that up to you. But what I want to do today, in case somebody hasn't seen an XML configuration or a Java configuration in Spring, we're going to go through and we're going to build an application, and I'm going to show you how to configure beans using XML in a Spring application. I'll show you how to use annotations or Java-based configuration to configure beans, and then we'll see how we can mix and match them and how using them both in the same application is perfectly fine. So with that, we are going to head over to start.spring.io. We're going to create a new application. I'm going to use Java and Maven, the latest version of Spring Boot. We're going to go in here and set some metadata. I'm going to say that. We'll call this the XML config. Sure. I'm just going to put this in this package here. We're going to use JDK 23, and all I'm going to pick is web. That's all we need for today. With that, we have everything we need. We can go ahead and hit the generate button, which is going to download a zip file. Then I can open it up in whatever my favorite IDE or text editor is. For me, that's going to be IntelliJ. I want you to use whatever you're most productive in, because that is the best editor or IDE that you should be using. With that, I think we have everything we need. Let's go ahead and write some code. All right, so let's get this application started. I'm going to refactor this to application. I just like to rename that. That's okay. We are ready to go. Now we're going to build out a couple things so we can kind of show this off, right? So I'm just going to build out a couple classes here. We're going to create a new Java class. I'm going to say this is a post, and this is going to be a record. And in this record, we will have an integer ID, a title, a body, a list of comments. So comment, we'll call this comments, and that looks good. Now I don't have a comment yet, so let's go ahead and create that. This is going to be a record, and this is just going to have a couple components to it. So we'll say integer ID, integer post ID, and string comment. Okay, so that satisfies this, and that looks okay now. So we're going to have a post controller. So let's go ahead and create a post controller. Now I should do a better job of kind of putting these into different packages, but we're just going to fly through this. So this is going to be a REST controller, and this is going to have a request mapping of /API/posts. And what we're going to do is we'll end up bringing in a post service and a comment service in just a second. But actually, yeah, let's go ahead and create those. So I need a post service. So let's say private final post service, and we don't have one of those yet. So let's go ahead and create a post service in here. And what is this post service going to do? At this point, it is actually not going to do anything, but that's okay. We'll get that through constructor injection. So there is our post service. Now it's complaining, and that's okay. I expect it to complain. We'll come back to that though. I'm also going to create a new, where are we at here? Let's say a comment service. So private final comment service, and we'll get that through. Oops, we need to create that first. So let's create a class. And this comment service is going to do a few things. We're going to create some comments here, and we're going to be able to find the comment by post ID. So that just turns this into a stream, looks for that based on a filter, and then returns a list. So nothing special here, but now we have a comment service and a post service, and we'll add that constructor parameter. And again, that's going to complain and say, I don't know where that thing is. I don't know what that is. And let's come back to our post controller. Let's add a quick method here. Maybe we'll have a get mapping in our post controller to say slash ID. And what we want to do is return a post find by ID. Let's say a path variable. And let's say that's an integer ID. And what did I do here? That's a list of comments. I'm looking for the find post by ID. This is really the find comment by ID, Dan. But that's okay. Let's just say we're looking for slash API slash posts slash ID. And we'll just use private list of posts. Posts is equal to new array list. So we'll initialize that. We'll have a constructor here that could take in a list of posts, but let's just initialize this. And actually, this is a really good opportunity to do this in using a post construct. So we'll say private void init. And then we'll say posts is equal to post.add. Let's just add a new post. And then again, the post takes in a ID, title, body, and list of comments. So let's say post is one. hello world. This is a new post, and let's just say a new array list. Actually, we can just set this to null. So that is going to satisfy that. And now I have at least one post. And now I can have a method to find by ID. So I can say public post find by ID. And this is going to take in an integer. Again, we're going to use the posts.stream. I don't even need to do this. Let's just return post.get. Right. So let's just return that and be done with it. Now, the real point of this is we're going to return post service dot find by ID, and that's just going to return that one that's in there. Now, the real point of this is that we have some classes in our system that we are asking for through dependency injection. Now, I will leave some links to some other videos that I've done on dependency injection and IOC or inversion of control. But the long story short here is that this post controller is dependent on two other classes. So when Spring goes and creates an instance of this post controller, which it will do, often called a bean, so a spring bean, which is really just a fancy way of saying, hey, I have this class and I've annotated it with some metadata so that I know about it. and that's really all a spring bean is. You can also go ahead and look this up in the documentation, but there are different ways to create spring beans, and we're going to talk about those here. But this creates an instance of post controller, and it has two dependencies. So for Spring to be able to create an instance of the post controller, it is asking for post service and comment service in its constructor. So Spring has to create this instance, and it needs to know where post service is and where comment service is if it's able to create an instance of the post controller. So how does it do this? And this is where the idea of configuration comes in and being able to define the different beans in our system. So I want to show you kind of how we did things before using XML configuration. And then we'll talk about Java configuration or annotation, which if you've been around Spring, you've probably seen now in any tutorial that you've done. So what I want to do is create a new file in here. I am going to call this application context.xml. And I got to create a little bit of boilerplate XML. I have a live template that does this for me, but essentially this is the configuration. These are all the beans in my system. So what I can do is I can come in here and define some different beans. I want to define something called post service, and then I am going to define where that class is. And that class is at dev.danvega.postService. So that is the fully qualified path to that post service. Now in here, I could define some arguments to post service, but in this case, there really are no arguments to post service. That is all we need to define. So I am going to copy this, and we're going to define one more, and we're going to say that this is the comment service, and this is located at dev.danvega.commentService, right? Okay, so we've defined some beans in our system, but right now, if we go back to our post controller, we're still getting this error because our application is not aware of this XML file, this configuration that we have there. So we can go ahead and tell it about it. We can say, hey, I want to import a resource. And for our sake, this is on the class path. So this is a class path resource. And we can just say application context.xml. And now if we go over to post controller, everything looks like it works. And if we were to go ahead and run our application, we should be able to run it without error. And everything looks like it works okay. So that is kind of one way. So you may have, if you have a legacy system that started off in Spring, maybe even before Spring Boot, you may have some configuration defined in XML. Now, there's not just legacy systems. This may be because, hey, we want people who are not developers to be able to make changes to this code. And so somebody could come in here and easily kind of change around some XML. So that may be another reason that it's in XML configuration. Now, I want to show you, I'm going to go ahead and mark these, comment these out. So if we go back to our post controller, we see that we have some problems there as well because it can't find those. Because again, when you do this, you are telling the system, hey, this is a class called post service. Here's where you can find it. So Spring knows, hey, I know where those are. So I can create an instance of this post controller because I know how to find those things. Now, another way you can do this is through Java configuration. Now, we can actually go out, write out the Java configuration if we wanted to. We can also use annotations. So if I come into comment service and I say that this is an at component or a specialized version of at component, which is like at service or at rest controller, like we have on the other one, at repository, etc., that is also going to suffice. So if we go over to post controller, you see comment service is now working. Post service is not, so we can easily come in here and we can say service. And now if we go to our post controller, those dependencies are satisfied. So I also want to show you that you could mix and match these. So let's go back to post service and just remove this. Go back to post controller, you see that we have an issue there. But if we come back over to our application.context and uncomment out this post service, then we have post-service working. So you can see we can mix our Java configuration with our XML configuration. Again, I thought this was a really interesting question and one I'm sure everyone has come across. So I appreciate that. And there it is, using XML configuration, using Java configuration, which one should I use? Again, functionality-wise, it doesn't really matter. You can do everything you need to do. You can go ahead and set up arguments in your bean configurations in XML. You can do it in Java configuration using annotation. I, for one, if I'm creating a new project using Spring Boot, I'm using annotation. So much simpler to do. Just put an annotation on a class. Boom, it's created. Now, it is important to understand those annotations. Like, the root of that is the at component annotation. That is signifying that this is going to be a component. This is going to be something I want Spring to manage for me. And those other ones, at service, at repository, those are just specialized versions of at component. But certainly, if you're in a legacy system, you can go ahead and mix and match these annotations. You create a new class, use the annotation, keep the existing XML configuration in place. It doesn't matter. So hey, first off, thanks again for that question. I love getting questions like this. So if you have your questions, please send them off to me. I'm on Twitter. Email me. You can email me at danvega@gmail.com. Certainly on GitHub, wherever you can find me. I do my best to get to all these questions. Sometimes they're a little overwhelming, so I apologize for that. But I love answering these questions, whether it's here or on Spring Office Hours. I love getting to these, so keep them coming. Thank you for that question. Hey, I hope you learned something new today. If you did, do me a big favor. Leave me a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel. And as always, friends, happy coding.